The Ozark Mountains hold many mysteries. Missing persons, strange lights in the night sky, old terrifying legends, but there exists something that woodsmen are encountering time and time again that the government doesn't want the public to know about. In fact, some of them have even been threatened for coming forward. You won't want to miss this one. One day in October of 2002, Timothy, a guy in his early 20s, spontaneously decided to go on an adventure with his friend C, and they had caught wind of a creek that kind of meandered from Springdale into the thick woods of Elm Springs, Arkansas. And so they were dead set on tracing its path to see where it went. And Timothy had a hunch that this adventure was going to be unlike their usual explorations. There was just something about the way the air felt, you know? The way the trees would just kind of sway in the breeze. It was like they were on the verge of something huge, a very exciting discovery. Now, in hindsight, he had no idea how accurate his statement would be. And so they would embark on a journey on a cool autumn afternoon, and the sun was just starting to set in the sky, but not enough to where it would signal that night was soon coming, just enough to show that it was later in the afternoon, and even the air itself carried this familiar smell of fallen leaves. And so Timothy and his friend were very much filled with anticipation, and they're walking along the creek bed, just listening to the soothing sounds of water flowing over the rocks. And as they kept going into the woods, the creek began to get smaller and smaller and more narrow, and the trees and foliage around them got denser, and you know, with their branches stretching out like twisted fingers. Timothy was already aware of the potential dangers in the area, because apparently there had been rumors circulating about of gang activity and even instances of bodies being buried in these same sections of woods. However, even with those possible risks involved, he couldn't resist the temptation to explore. And so he called out to his friend because he had heard there's this spot about 5 miles in where the woods get really thick, and he began to tell his friend that that's where they're gonna find the good spots. And so his friend nodded in response, and he smiled, and he asked Timothy to show him the way, and so they just started going further in that direction. And now Timothy noticed right away that C was acting a little off. It's like he was acting mysterious or just odd. Like it seemed like he had a lot of knowledge about the area that he wasn't revealing. And Timothy didn't really push it. He just started to suspect that his friend might have ulterior motives as they ventured deeper into the woods. And so as they kept going and following the creek, the woods became strangely quiet, but at the same time, Timothy just felt this calmness envelop him. And as they got closer to the 5 mile mark, remember they had been walking for quite a ways at this point, the creek bed began to incline even more, making the banks now steeper and harder to traverse. And so Timothy, being the taller one out of the two, thought it would now be a great idea to try and climb up and just get a better view of the area around them. And so Timothy could feel his heart beating out of his chest out of excitement as he climbs up higher on the embankment so he could see better, because the idea of going up there by himself made him nervous. And so he just began scolding himself, being like, you know, come on, don't be a wimp, get yourself up there, you can do it. And you know, he took a moment or so to collect himself before asking his friend for assistance. And so he turns around and says, hey, you know, would you mind giving me a hand? And he places his foot on his friend's hand, and C, you know, is kind of struggling to lift Timothy up because he's a bigger dude. And so they just so happen to kind of lift him up enough to where he can get over the embankment. And so Timothy stands up, he's dusting himself off, and he suddenly stops. Because over around 75 yards to his left, he noticed that there was something that filled him with dread. Initially, he thought it could be a bear because of its size and brown color, but As he's looking at it and inspecting it, he realized this wasn't a bear. This was absolutely terrifying. Timothy was completely overwhelmed by what it was he was witnessing. His mind immediately just started racing because he had never seen this animal before. And before he could even process the situation, this large animal began moving toward him, and it actually moved with this hunch and a slow gait. And Timothy was realizing that this was not just a trick of the light or something he casually imagined. This was actually happening, and it was coming directly towards him. And he felt himself begin to panic as he realized that he was on top of the creek bed with no easy way to get back down to where C was waiting. And so he's looking around panicking, desperately trying to find a way out. But this thing is now closing and rapidly getting closer and closer with alarming speed as it's just kind of like barreling its way through the foliage and brush. And now he's so overwhelmed, and he has just fear and confusion clouding his thoughts. He's thinking, what is this thing? It's definitely not a bear. And he's hyperventilating. He's struggling to catch his breath and realizing he had to move now. He just glanced down at his friend C, who was still very much so patiently waiting at the bottom of the creek bed, completely oblivious to the danger that was now getting closer. And so Timothy just shouts down him real quick, "Hey!" And he just tells him, "We gotta go now." And as you can imagine, C's looking up at him thinking like, what are you talking about? What's the big deal? But just as Timothy was about to respond, this animal just screamed this horrific roar that shook them both. And now they realized, at least C can now realize the gravity of the situation, because this sound was so raw and angry and terrifying. And so Timothy, not waiting any longer, is just like, you know what, screw it. And he starts to go down the embankment as fast as he can. And he's really struggling to maintain his footing because he's trying to go quick and the dirt is loose and rocks are falling. And this thing is growing closer and closer. And the closer it gets, the ground is starting to tremble. And so fortunately, Timothy is able to reach the creek bed without falling on his face. His heart is nearly pounding out of his chest. He's breathing heavy. And of course, C is standing there with him, terrified, very confused, looking at him with a mix of confusion and just trying to think of like, what on earth is happening here? But Timothy's grabbing him, being like, listen, we don't got time to talk. We need to go now. And so the two of them just start sprinting, dashing through the creek as quickly as they could in the direction they originally came. And you could only imagine the pure rush of adrenaline that was coursing through their bodies. I mean, they were probably scared out of their mind just trying to get away from this mysterious animal. I mean, they were too scared to even glance behind them, fearing what they might witness. And as they're running, Timothy is just overwhelmed by feelings and thoughts of just, what on earth is this? Are we gonna die out here? Is this my last moments? But all he could really care about in that moment was finding safety and solace, getting back to civilization, and never going back to this portion of woods ever again. Now, finally, at some point or another, after what seemed like them running forever, they were able to make it out of the creek bed, and they actually found themselves on this dirt road that would lead conveniently back to Springdale. And so they collapsed on the ground, breathing heavily, and they're basically just pouring sweat. They're trembling. And as you can imagine, Timothy just fell right to the floor. He's gasping for air. He can't control his trembling legs. He had never sprinted so quickly or hard before ever in his life. And as they're sitting there just trying to catch their breath and make sense of what happened, Timothy just glanced over at C, anticipating that he would mirror the fear and confusion that Timothy himself was experiencing. But to his surprise, C just had this huge smile on his face, and he almost kind of had this mischievous sparkle in his eye. And all C could think of is like, holy crap, we just encountered a Bigfoot and we survived. And so the animal that Timothy saw, or at least what he could see, is what he would describe as huge, legs as wide as tree trunks. It was covered in thick, tangled hair, and it had really broad shoulders. It measured easily 3 or 4 feet. The head had this stretched out oval shape, and it had deep, shadowed eyes and a face that had a striking resemblance to a human being. Now, Timothy couldn't believe what he was hearing from his friend. He just couldn't understand that his friend could be so nonchalant about something so terrifying. And so they start arguing. He's like, Are you kidding me? That was the most intense, terrifying moment. Like, that was a close call. We could have died. But I mean, if you think about it, people do handle fear and trauma in different ways. And so if you look at C's reaction and Timothy's reaction, it does truly demonstrate that. And even afterwards, Timothy was deeply affected by the experience, while C was extremely excited and exhilarated by it. And even during the course of their arguments, he just kept telling Timothy, yeah, we could have died, but we didn't. We survived, and now we have this incredible story to share for the rest of our lives. But of course, for Timothy, this experience was far too tiring and emotionally draining, and so he just simply wanted to just put it away and leave the memory where it was. Now, as far as the huge, hairy animal with the weird-shaped head and creepy eyes that Timothy and C sort of saw in the thick woods of Elm Springs, Arkansas, in the Ozarks, we'll probably never know where it came from or what it was. One November night in 1999, Paul found himself standing outside his home in rural Arkansas during the fall. And it was about 9 p.m. in his property, which covered roughly 24 acres near the border of Washington and Madison counties in the Ozarks, and it was completely dark except for the faint moonlight that was kind of sort of shining through the trees. Now, at this point, Paul was very deep in thought, looking out at the vast expanse of the dense forest and the Ozarks, and remember that this surrounded his yard, when suddenly, this disturbing noise broke the silence. It was this long, horrific howl, and it was just kind of echoing through the area and the trees, and it almost filled the entire night. And instantly, Paul found himself becoming very still, listening intently as this sound would echo twice more in just 15 seconds' time. And he just felt this sudden wave of cold wash over him, thinking that what on earth is this noise? He felt completely bewildered. Obviously, for Paul, there was just something very off about it that he couldn't quite identify, but he was already really familiar with the animals in the area. And this noise really stuck out to him. It bothered him. And he was initially curious that if this could actually be his grandfather next door just pulling a prank on him. And since his wife had already been gone for a couple of weeks, and so he's now convinced that it was his grandfather. And so he shouts, "That's a good way to get shot." But, you know, he didn't hear anything. Because instead of a timid laugh in response, the loud cry would echo out again, two more times, in fact. And at this point, Paul's dogs, who were a couple of coon hounds, a rat terrier and a shepherd mutt, just dashed off the porch, barking and growling as if they could sense some sort of hidden danger lurking in the shadows. And this sudden wave of fear just completely took Paul over. And he's thinking that, okay, there's clearly something wrong here. And so he quickly rushes indoors, snatches his .22 rifle, and then he carefully ventures back outside, and he's following the tree line towards the west direction. And at this point, he's thinking, oh my gosh, I'm going crazy. And he's just mumbling to himself. He's very nervous. And as he's picking up his gun and he's kind of like trembling because he doesn't know what he's dealing with, he's really confused and overwhelmed, and he's just trying to figure out what's going on. And so for a while, Paul would try and follow the sounds of something large moving and breaking branches, and he could hear his dogs chasing after this thing, but it was too hidden amongst the dense vegetation. And so at this point, he kind of trailed behind the noise as best he could. He's completely petrified. And now he starts to hear these loud footsteps that are almost trampling through the bushes. And all of a sudden, he noticed that his brave dogs were completely gone. And their barks are now very far away. And so there's Paul, completely stuck in the darkness by himself, feeling very vulnerable. While whatever this mysterious thing is just carries on with its flight, seemingly unaffected by his attempts to catch up to it. And he just suddenly has this chilling realization that The dogs aren't following me anymore. This cannot be good. And as he's just slipping into a deeper bout of anxiety, I have to know what this is. And so he's burning for answers. But there is something not right about the footsteps that were happening in front of him. They were too heavy. They were breaking through too much underbrush. They sounded much larger than any animal he'd ever heard. And not to mention, his dogs were now suddenly falling behind and retreating and whining. It was like there was something there unnatural in the woods that wanted to hurt him, or at least hurt them. And so at this point, he's thinking that he should turn back, but his curiosity and adrenaline kept pushing him forward like a fool because he had to know what this was. And eventually the sounds kind of just faded off in the distance. And so he's still shaking at this point, but he decides that it's probably time to go home. And as he makes his way back to his property, he immediately calls his grandparents because remember, they live right next door. And so he calls his grandmother and he's kind of chewing her out because he suspects it was them, or at least maybe. And he goes on about like some of the weird stuff that's happening. And he's like, gosh, I really hope it's just them pulling a prank. Please. But his grandfather on the other end quickly confirmed that he had been home all evening and there was absolutely no way that this old man could have made these weird sounds or moved so quickly. And as they start talking about that he had heard the weird noises too, Paul's stomach just churns in this realization because he's now facing this undeniable reality. He had encountered something supernatural out there in the Ozarks hiding. And after a while, after he's kind of able to calm himself down and at least come back to somewhat of a normal level, he starts thinking back to some of the stories that his granddad had told him when he was younger, you know, legends of like the Ozark Howler and just other weird stuff that had happened in the Ozark Mountains years ago by fur trappers and woodsmen and hunters all alike. And he's starting to think, you know, there might be some truth to those old legends and tales, that maybe these weren't just folklore. Maybe they were genuine experiences that just got written off over time, but there's clearly something here. And whatever it was very much aware of my presence. Now, regarding the strange sounds that Paul had heard coming from the woods that November 9th, the loud footsteps and breaking branches that he followed for a long distance, his dogs suddenly getting spooked and running back, and of course, the undeniable feeling that he had disturbed some mysterious supernatural entity that was hiding in the darkness, well, we'll never know for sure. It remains a mystery. Now, the Ozarks has a lot of history of strange things like we've been discussing, and it doesn't just relate to one thing. I mean, you have the Ozark Howler, you have a multitude of strange things that would honestly probably take an entire video series to cover even just a quarter of it. So we just kind of work with what we do. But to try and understand at least some of the history behind this, we need to go way back to around 1865 to be exact, and there was a gentleman by the name of Collins who had decided to head out to the mountains right near Spring Creek for his deer hunting trip during the fall winter. And as he strolled through this beautiful snow, he was able to spot these strange footprints. Now, Collins was quite the seasoned tracker, and even these took him aback because they were unlike anything he had seen before. I mean, these were massive and they had very weird claw marks in the snow. And as he's looking at these, he could already tell that this isn't a bear. And so even though it made him a little nervous, he just decided to continue following the trail and just kind of see that whatever had made these, maybe it's close by because again, it's in the late fall, early winter, it's snowing, so it was relatively fresh. And as he kept on going into the wilderness, making his way towards the northern slopes of the Upper Twain Mountain, he couldn't help but feel that something really incredible was about to happen. And all of a sudden, there was this eruption of loud noise coming from above and out of nowhere. And these huge boulders kind of just started rolling down the hill straight towards him. Thinking quickly, he skillfully avoided these tumbling rocks and suddenly spotted this colossal figure that just completely astonished him. There it was, this massive being that was easily towering over 10 feet, strong muscles, curly black hair, and the strangest of all is it had a strange deep blue shine in the sunlight, and it had this massive club in its hand, swinging it around with incredible strength. It was absolutely terrifying. So Collins was really scared, and when this thing set down its club to get another boulder to throw at him, he's like, you know what, I'm out of here. I ain't sticking around. He turns around and he quickly sprints back to town. Now, after arriving, he tells everybody in town what he had experienced, and he's able to round up a bunch of other guys and hunters to go after this thing. And in fact, this would be the event, supposedly, that would earn this being the nickname of the Big Blue Man. And so they would spend days just scouring the wilderness, trying to track this thing's path, and they would sometimes stumble upon this grisly assortment of evidence from its kills. I mean, sheep skins, pig skins, deceased dogs, bones, feathers, and more. And they would actually stumble upon this burrow that was packed with all sorts of leftovers of this thing's meals. However, no matter how hard they tried, they were never able to get a good look at this thing, let alone catch it. And thus, the tale of the Big Blue Man of the Ozarks came to be, and it really has been a tale that's been handed down from one generation to the next ever since. Now, it's pretty obvious that there's still a whole lot of unknowns when it comes to this being, but one thing is for certain is that it made a huge impression on the folks and the folklore in the area. And actually, this wouldn't be the end, because years later in 1874, the story of the Big Blue Man suddenly resurfaced again. And so this farmer who was out looking for his lost lambs suddenly came across this being right near Spring Creek. And 2 days after that, another man, I think by the name of Cap Turner, would find himself face to face with the Big Blue Man. And of course, he couldn't believe his eyes as it effortlessly would catch fish out of the Indian Creek with its bare hands. And so as this same creature also began running after him and it swung this huge supposedly axe that it had, Turner quickly ran down a steep hillside, completely terrified. And these were just a handful of secondhand stories that would pop up over and over again during this time, and they kept coming. Everyone seemed to be collectively adding to the pot of stories of their own weird experiences of seeing this thing or encountering this thing. And then there was also a gentleman by the name of Cal Alsup who was really curious about it. And so as it turns out, when he was out to try and find this thing, apparently he found the cavern in which this thing lived. He had found some dried sheep's fur scattered across the cave floor, as if it were the leftovers from one of its meals. And it appeared that the Big Blue Man had a liking for farm animals. Now, not much is known about what happened after that, but if we jump ahead to November of 1924, the residents of Northern Howell and Douglas counties were completely stricken with fear when this thing appeared to be all over the place, from Tater Hill to Collins Ford, from Blue Buck to Abba Crossing. Farmers had to keep a very close watchful eye on their livestock. Everybody was armed to the teeth, and the livestock were carefully guarded and protected from any potential harm. And at this point, you had posses of men scouring the area, determined to eliminate this menace once and for all. I mean, these were some really brave souls who were gonna go in the line of duty and go against this thing. And apparently there were also those who had claimed that they even shot at this thing and survived. And apparently the story goes that a bunch of these hunters were successful in herding this thing up into the trees and were amazed at seeing its weird blue color. But despite their best efforts, nobody could capture it, nobody could kill it, and any physical proof or evidence to suggest the Big Blue Man exist or ever existed just remains word of mouth. And over time, these sightings became less and less frequent, and the Big Blue Man just seemed to disappear completely, only to show up again in 1911. And this time, it looked like the creature was not doing so well. Its strong body was supposedly now weakened by either old age or sickness. And it's also quite concerning that, even at this point, farmers were still reporting several cases of missing animals and livestock, so it clearly still had a very healthy appetite for meat and livestock. And actually, the Washington Times published a really interesting story about how the beast changed. But there was this also crazy story from these two kids who said they saw this big blue man pop up out of the ground. And as reported in the Sentinel, the boys guided a group of men to the location where they stumbled upon a frequently used entrance to an underground cavern. So this guy goes inside and he's got a lantern, he's got everything he needs to try and find it. And can you guess what he sees? Well, this is where it gets crazy. Apparently, this thing that resembled a man was just kind of like huddled back in this cave. It wore nothing but a loincloth made out of animal skin. And this thing had a coat of short bluish hair, and its head was adorned with a wild mane. And so supposedly the group was able to catch it, but it didn't say a word, like it couldn't or didn't want to talk. And in the cave, they also stumbled upon various remnants of its presence, like wool, hair, bones, and feathers, but there was no sign of any cooked food. But again, like the other segments of the story, nothing seemed to come of this captured blue man, which is very interesting. And after that, nobody really heard anything else. But fast forward to 1925, and the story of the blue man made another comeback, because in that year, a postmaster in Nevada received a very interesting inquiry from a man in California, along with a newspaper clipping about a strange creature. A portion of the postmaster's reply was actually featured in the Nevada Daily News back in March of 1925, and it included some really unsettling information. The postmaster mentioned that even though the original blue man had passed away, there were still many of his offspring living freely along the banks of Spring Creek. Now, according to him, these kids were completely blue, didn't wear any clothing, and survived by eating raw meat from animals like bears, feral cats, mountain lions, you name it. And what's even more surprising is how the postmaster described their appearance. Now, according to him, a lot of them were towering to 8 feet tall, weighed a whopping 300 to 500 pounds, and apparently there were people who claimed to have seen these huge blue-skinned beings carrying young horses or cows on their shoulders as they went back to their burrows or caves. And of course, the postmaster's last warning was definitely the most disturbing of all. And he warned that going out at night in these areas could be extremely dangerous and advised against taking any sort of risk. Now, even though people claim to still see Bigfoot in the Ozarks, the famous Big Blue Man of Spring Creek, who used to throw boulders and mysteriously vanished in 1915 and was never spotted again, well, we still don't know the real deal with this whole thing. I mean, what really happened? Was it just a case of everybody freaking out, a prank, or maybe something genuinely out of this world? We'll probably never find out for sure. Now, unfortunately, regarding the legend of the Big Blue Man, there pretty much exists no evidence at all other than just secondhand stories and tales passed down through the years, unfortunately. And it's also unclear if the current Bigfoot situation in the Ozarks is in any way related to the Big Blue Man. Are they the same thing? Is the Big Blue Man a sect of these beings? Are they Nephilim? Are they giants? Well, we don't know. The entire history of the Big Blue Man and everything surrounding it and the Bigfoot and all of that, it all remains a mystery, folks. And because you guys made it this far into the episode, I want you to all comment down below right now. Do it right now. Pause the video and do it. The Ozark mystery. So that way, I know who made it to the end of the episode and who didn't. And if you guys enjoy content like this, where we go into the storytelling of all things unexplained, strange, mysterious, and supernatural, then you should totally hit that like and subscribe button for more content just like this. As always, I love you all. Keep an open mind. And my nose is itching like crazy all of a sudden. I'm very sorry. I'll see you all in the very next episode.